Podcast.
People will do anything for money.
After building all the pipelines, after spraying all the gas, after desecrating graveyards, being told they shall not pass, after shooting all the horses, after driving in with tanks, after sending in the dogs with soldiers in their ranks, they're standing up at Standing Rock.
We kept being told that they were coming for us. They, as in the police and the military.
Property will be arrested.
So we both walked out to the easement. Mark got about 20, 30 feet away from the construction and was tackled by five officers, riot officers, and a few times they hit him, and that's when the riot line lined up on the easement and started pushing us back. I dropped to the ground, and first I was crying and telling them those were grandmothers there digging up. At some point, we all realized we couldn't step back anymore, and so we hugged each other and cried.
Also, Wasser ist natürlich das Wichtigste. Rohmaterial, das wir heute noch auf der Welt haben. Und es geht darum, ob wir das normale Wasserversorgung der Bevölkerung privatisieren oder nicht. Und da gibt es zwei verschiedene Anschauungen. Die eine Anschauung, extrem würde ich sagen, wird von einigen von den NGOs vertreten, die darauf pochen, dass Wasser zu einem öffentlichen Recht erklärt wird. Das heißt, als Mensch sollten Sie einfach Recht haben, um Wasser zu haben. Das ist die eine Extremlösung.
And because Nestle owns this land, the company can take as much water as it wants for a $200 a year permit fee, if there's no harm to the environment. But locals here say the damage is clear.
Well, this is supposed to be the headwaters of Chippewa Creek.
Where it starts.
Where this creek begins. According to Nestle, there should be water here. Don't see much.
Why are you opposed to what Nestle's doing here?
Well, we're opposed to bottled water, and we're opposed to privatizing water. They're taking the water, putting it in plastic bottles, selling it outside of the watershed, and making a huge profit off of water that doesn't belong to them. The water belongs to the people.
Locals we spoke to accuse Nestle of trying to cover up traces of environmental damage by offering to replace local infrastructure, like this culvert, where water markings show how levels have dropped significantly over time.
So the water used to be up that high,
yeah,
now it's this low?
2 feet higher.
Okay.
Which would have placed it up above the stones here.
So you guys, Michigan Citizens for Water Conservation, made noise about how you can tell the water has gone down. And right away they offered to replace the structures?
At the next public meeting, they made that offer.
Do you want them to do that?
No.
Why?
Because it would destroy this evidence.
Arlene Anderson-Vincent is the natural resource manager for Nestle Waters North America.
Why do you think there was so much local opposition to Nestle increasing its pumping there?
We have lots of strong partnerships with residents and local businesses and business leaders. I don't know if I'm not sure how much local opposition that there is.
For every dollar that they earn, down throughout the ages, all they do is make things worse. It's not a stretch to point out that these people are a curse. It may seem slightly vengeful, but sometimes payback's a bitch. Time to eat the rich. Some people think they're funny, they follow every tweet. But me, I just get hungry and I want something to eat. Let's be environmental.
Table, the mouths are choking, but I'm going.
Hey guys, welcome back to my channel here. It's Lavender here, and today I want to make an anti-capitalism, anti-imperialist video today. So today I am doing the video that I wanted to be talking about today called The War Over Water Has Already Begun. Deep dive into this topic. So let's get started into this anti-capitalism video. So here we go. So imperialist Kamala Harris has said wars will be fought over oil, and now wars will be fought over water in the near future while visiting a vaccination site in Chicago on Tuesday. The sad thing is that the true reality is that the war over water has already begun. It's been going on for years now. Here are some examples of what I am talking about of it. So, access to clean, safe, and affordable drinking water is not just a concern of developing countries, but everywhere across the globe we live on. An example of these water wars is when Nestle and Coca-Cola tried to privatize water, and on top of that, the former Nestle CEO said that water is not a human right, and that water should be privatized like the capitalist pig that he is. In South America, by the way, all the articles are going to be linked down below in the description box in the YouTube video, so yeah. In South America, that one of the world's largest reservoirs of fresh water, aquifers, could soon fall into the hands of capitalist pig corporations such as Coca-Cola and Nestle. According to reports in the media press, talks to privatize the Guarani Aquifer, a vast subterranean water reservoir laying beneath Argentina, Brazil, Paraguay, and Uruguay, have already reached an advanced stage. The aquifer is the world's second largest underground water reserve, and it is estimated to be capable of providing the world's population with drinking water for up to 200 years. Environmental groups, social movements, and land defenders warn that the exploitation of the freshwater reservoir could see the 460,000 square mile, 1.2 million square kilometers, reservoir sacrificed for the short-term profits of, you know, agri businesses, energy, and food and drink giants. For global behemoths like the U.S.-based Coca-Cola and Swiss Nestle corporations, the extraction and sale of drinking water is a finite resource and a basic necessity for all living beings on this earth. It is especially lucrative. Water intended for public use is enriched with various minerals or combined with cheap sweeteners and other ingredients before being bottled and sold at a massive profits by companies such as Coca-Cola and Nestle. Another example is the Flint water crisis. Wars over water. Michigan fights to avoid delivering water to Flint residents. The ongoing crisis, the Flint water crisis, have left the city without safe drinking water for over 2 years. But the state claims water deliveries are too much to ask. This article came out in 2016. Flint is a major African American community and one of the nation's poorest cities in America. Public health experts say that about 99,000 people of Flint residents were exposed to high levels of lead in their drinking water and tap waters. This is environmental racism, because capitalism and racism go hand in hand. Just like capitalism profits put people's lives, you know, they don't care about people's lives, they put, you know, profits over human lives. Michigan is fighting a judge's order to deliver water to Flint residents who do not have safe drinking water, claiming it would be overly expensive for taxpayers and that it is too time-consuming to do. The Herculean effort required by the court order would be on the magnitude of a large-scale military operation. Anna Heaton, spokeswoman for the capitalist pig genocidal governor, Rick Snyder, the state's motion says it would cost at least $10 million monthly to deliver water for the estimated 400,000 cases of water each week, and warns that using Flint relief money for water delivery could defund other efforts like nutritional assistance programs for kids. In 2014, after Flint the Flint, Michigan's left Detroit's water system and started drawing water from the heavy polluted, toxic-ass, biohazard-ass Flint River. Residents began complaining about the tap water's metallic toxic taste, and black like coffee-like water appearance, and claimed it was causing health issues. Michigan's Department of Environmental Quality initially denied that there was any issues with the water. This is a capitalist pig cover-up because they knew what was going on with the water and they failed to disclose it. Capitalism puts profits over human lives every day in this world and on Earth. This is no exception. The city, under the state's direction, has failed to treat water with chemicals that prevent corrosion, allowing lead from the lines of pipes to get into the water. Any amount of lead exposure is a health risk, particularly for young children in the area, and can stunt their brain development and growth in any way. Both Snyder and the federal government have been widely condemned for their poor handling of the Flint water crisis, with some critics calling the denial of essential service to the city's predominantly black residents, many of who are poor, a case of environmental racism, which it is. And also, the Flint water crisis is actually a Catless Pig cover-up by Porky. So this is another example of the wars over water. You know, I mean, they won't even give them water, and they keep saying that there is no crisis. It's ridiculous. Another example is the Standing Rock protests are another example. The Standing Rock tribe in North and South Dakota, for instance, relies on the lake, a 231-mile reservoir along the Missouri River, as its primary source of water. In July 2016, the U.S. Army Corporation of Engineers approved the construction of the Dakota Access Pipeline, over a thousand mile pipeline that will carry crude oil from North Dakota to Illinois. When completed, will run underneath the Missouri River less than a mile north of Standing Rock Reservation, including through the tribe's sacred ancestral lands. Given concerns about having oil-related infrastructure near a major water source and how it could spill, you know, into the water and destroy the water, especially after the Deepwater Horizon oil spill in 2010, the largest oil spill in U.S. waters, in U.S. coastal waters, members of the tribe have been vigorously defending their rights to safe and clean drinking water, reasonably so. Native indigenous tribes that rely on hunting and fishing for subsistence depend on cleanliness of not only their local water supply, but of the entire of the ecosystem feeding the water source, which could be affected hundreds of miles if there were to be an oil spill. People in the event, the natives were violently attacked by the racist police, aka the helpers and watchdogs of Porky, aka the Catless Pigs. I made a Vlogmas video about this last year about how we should abolish the police, so if you want to go check that video out, just look up Vlogmas Abolish the Police, and my video should come up. And I go into detail in that video about the evil police and the Catless Pigs and the evils of capitalism, and I go more into the subject of the Standing Rock protests, so yeah. Police stood guard as fire hoses blasted anti-Dakota Access Pipeline activists on a bridge near Standing Rock in sub-freezing cold temperatures. A medic on the scene described seeing mass hypothermia and severe hand and head injuries from rubber bullets the police had fired. Two soaking wet men complained of being gassed with smoke bombs, tear gas, and mace. A man shot in the head by a rubber bullet is bandaged and carted away in a hitchback. People are choking. People are crying. Standing Rock activist faces prison after officer shot him in the face. Marcus Michelle, who was severely injured when a beanbag pellet entered his eye socket, was charged with trespassing after the protest. A federal judge later threw out his lawsuit that claimed that he was his civil rights were violated during these Dakota Access Pipeline protests. You know, his lawsuit was thrown out. And last but not least, an example of these water wars is the effect that climate change will have on the wars over water. So in 2016, the year I graduated high school, it was a particularly hot year. Record-shattering temperatures that that summer have scorched countries all the way from Morocco to Saudi Arabia and beyond, as climate experts warn that severe weather could be a severe sign of worse to come, as in climate change, weather-related patterns. So climate scientists predict that the mushrooming populations of the Middle East and North Africa will face extreme water scarcity, temperatures almost too hot for human survival, and other consequences of global warming as climate change, you know, worsens. If that happens, conflicts such as the refugee crisis will get worse. Jihad, Saudi Arabia, recorded an all-time high temperature of nearly 126 degrees. Southern Morocco's relatively cooler climate suddenly sizzled last month, with temperatures surging to highs between 109 degrees and 116 degrees. In May, record-breaking temperatures in Israel led to a surge in heat-related illnesses such as heat stroke. Temperatures started rising above 120 degrees, and metal objects outside turned into hot, searing hot biohazards. I mean, and hazards.